Hi friends, now we are going to see a very complicated topic, that is intersexuality, and we all find it difficult to remember the causes, the pattern and the genetical and anatomical features. And whenever the MCQs are asked on these topics, a clinical scenario is given and over there you have to evaluate what exactly is that particular condition and then accordingly you have to decide the treatment. So with some diagrams, we have tried to make this very simple. I hope this presentation will help you to understand this complex topic. In human, we have 22 autosomes and one pair of sex chromosome. Presence of Y chromosome leads to the sex determining region, that is SRY on Y chromosome. That decides what would be the gonad in the baby. So once there is presence of Y chromosome, long arm SRY, the gonad is always testes. Once there is absence of Y, that means when the chromosomes are XX, automatically there is formation of ovaries as gonads. So to concise this, every embryo is actually a female, is destined to or is programmed to convert into a female, unless otherwise, if there is presence of Y chromosome, then the program changes and then there is formation of testes, then there is formation of Wolfian duct. Otherwise, every baby is actually programmed to become a female. So when there is presence of Y, then the gonads get selected as testes. When Y is absent, then gonads, they become ovaries. External anatomical sex is the fat distribution, whether it is feminine, breast development, it changes in both the sexes, pubic and axillary hair, and external genitalia. These are all, they form external anatomical sex. And internal sex would be presence of uterus, tubes, ovaries. So these are internal organs. So now let's see in detail. In males, what happens? Y chromosome, testes. Testes have Sertoli cells, Leydig cells. Sertoli cells, they secrete anti-Müllerian substance or hormone. And this anti-Müllerian hormone inhibits the formation of Müllerian duct, which is actually programmed to form in every baby. So once there is testes presence, anti-Müllerian substance would be secreted and that will inhibit Müllerian duct development. Leydig cells, they secrete testosterone. Testosterone promotes Wolfian duct development, that is the formation of ductus and testicular system and conduction system. Testosterone gets converted into dehydrotestosterone, which is actually the active form of testosterone, which goes and acts on the receptors. And this is possible only when if there is presence of 5-alpha reductase hormone. This dehydrotestosterone has role in development of the external genitalia. Edges of the urogenital sinus, they fuse and there is formation of penile urethra. The labioscrotal fold fuse and there is formation of scrotum. There is genital tubercle which hypertrophies under the influence of dehydrotestosterone and there would be formation of penis. So this was in male. Now in females, XX, what happens? Ovary as the gonad. When there is ovarian formation, there is no Müllerian inhibiting substance or hormone. So that leads to Müllerian duct formation. Müllerian ducts, they form uterus, upper part of vagina and fallopian tubes. From ovary, there is no secretion of testosterone. So naturally, there is no stimulation of Wolfian duct formation. And there is feminization of the external genitalia because of absence of testosterone. So what? From urogenital sinus, there is formation of lower vagina and urethra. Urogenital sinus, it forms labia minora as well. And the labioscrotal fold, it remains open, forms labia majora and genital tubercle, which is not at all hypertrophied, forms clitoris. Now, the steroid hormone production. Cholesterol, it forms progesterone. Progesterone, under the influence of 21 beta hydroxylase, get converted into aldosterone. From progesterone only, there is 17 alpha hydroxyprogesterone conversion. And under the influence of Again, 21 beta hydroxylase, there is formation of cortisol. So these two are the steroid hormones which are required for normal body function. If there are no steroids, there would be crisis. So this is actually before the androstenedione or steroid, other androgens get formed. This is the steroid formation from cholesterol to progesterone to either aldosterone or cortisol. These are required for our life. So these are the hydrocorts formed from progesterone, and hormone required for this is 21 beta hydroxylase. Please remember this important hormone. Next, what happens from 17 alpha hydroxyprogesterone, there is formation of dehydroepiandrosterone, that is DHEA, and under the influence of 17 beta hydroxylase, there is formation of testosterone, and this testosterone gets converted into dehydro or the DHT, that is dehydrotestosterone, which is the active form, and dehydroepiandrosterone gets aromatized either peripherally or in the gonad, and there is formation of estradiol, that is the estrogen formation. So this is the steroid hormone production in which cortisol as well as testosterone and estradiol formation is shown. This is a very important diagram which we have to remember throughout this. Hermaphrodite, there can be true hermaphrodite or there can be pseudo hermaphrodite. What do we mean by this hermaphrodite? Hermaphrodite means the genetic sex is of one type and phenotypic sex is of another type. True, there would be genotype and phenotype would be mixed or ambiguous, but there is presence of ovaries and testes both. Both the gonads are present, that is called as true hermaphrodite. Pseudo hermaphrodite, the genotype will be of one sex and phenotype would be of another sex. Now we are going to see many reasons or many examples of pseudo hermaphrodite, and that is what is intersexuality, where actually the person is genetically either male but appears as female, or genetically the person is female but appears as male. Many eunuchs are from this groups. Let's see. In male pseudo hermaphrodite, once it is male, then remember there has to be presence of XY. So the genotype is XY. As there is presence of Y, there is formation of testes, but because of some reason, the external genitalia are feminized. There is incomplete fusion of labioscrotal fold, or there would be hypospadias, and the genitalia will appear underdeveloped or they will look like female. And the most common cause of male pseudohermaphrodite is androgen insensitivity syndrome, or it is also called as testicular feminizing syndrome. There are enzyme deficiencies, either 5-alpha reductase or 17-beta hydroxylase, and these enzymes, they are deficient because there is no active formation, there is no formation of active component of testosterone, and as well as there is no formation of testosterone from dehydroepiandrosterone. So because of that, or maybe because of peripheral receptivity of the receptors is absent. The peripheral receptors are not receptive to the testosterone which is present. So in that particular case, there the testosterone effect will not be seen. And even though the person is male, the phenotype would appear as female. Even sometimes when the testes are resistant to the gonadotroph, so like there would be secretion of FSH, but testes will not produce testosterone, then high level of FSH would be there. This is called as testicular failure. Again, the person will appear, it will look as a female, but genotypically the person would be male. Antimullerian deficiency factor, in that if the factor is deficient, the internal genitalia will be formed from the Mullerian system and the person is a hermaphrodite. Now coming to the other part, that is female, the genotype is XX. There would be presence of ovaries, but on the opposite side, even though the ovaries are present, the external genitalia would be masculinized. There would be fusion of the labioscrotal fold and clitoris would be hypertrophied, and that will look like male external genitalia. Commonest cause of female pseudohermaphrodite is congenital adrenal hyperplasia. This can be congenital or maybe late onset, that is called as adrenogenital syndrome. aromatase deficiency, or this may happen if there are drugs which are causing these virilizing changes in the fetus. Ovarian tumors which secrete virilizing substances or androgens can also be the cause where the external genitalia of the female fetus would look like male genitalia. So this is in short hermaphroditism. Let's now see one by one the common syndromes. First, very important, commonly seen Turner syndrome or gonadal dysgenesis. Phenotype is like a female, the female, but maybe not exactly like a female. Genotype, you know that Turner's means there is absence of other X. The genotype is XO, only one X is present. There can be mosaicism where there is combination of either XO and XX or XO and XY. Mosaicism means in one single person, two types of cell lines are present. That is called as mosaic. Gonads in Turner, because it is XO, there is no Y, so the gonads would be ovary. But these ovaries are not well developed. They are streak gonads. So they don't really secrete estrogen. That is why internal genitalia, that is fallopian tubes and uterus, will be hypoplastic. External genitalia will also be underdeveloped. Even secondary sexual characteristics like breast would be atrophied. Scanty pubic hair would be there. So even though there is presence of X, the other X is absent. So the complete feminine picture would be absent. And sometimes because of presence of XY, maybe there is appearance like a male internal syndrome. Other features are short stature, webbing of neck, cubitus valgus. Investigation to differentiate would be karyotyping, XO, Turner's. In this patient, treatment, the main form is the gonads are streak. They always have the risk of forming either gonadoblastoma or dysgerminoma of this gonadal, the streak gonads. So they are at risk of having this malignancy. So first thing, we have to remove these gonads, and then if the person has been rendered as a female since childhood, we can help her by having external supplements of estrogen. That will save her from osteoporosis also, and other things like breast development and other hormonal things would be balanced with the supplements of estrogen. So a person, if the clinical scenario is given that atrophied breast and cubitus valgus is present, short stature, webbing of neck, and there is presence of hypoplastic uterus, patient coming with primary amenorrhea, what would be the likely diagnosis? So once these features are given, immediately you have to think about Turner syndrome. I hope you are with me and you are understanding this thing. Again, I am taking you to the steroid hormone production slide, because the next topic which we are going to see is the deficiency of 17-beta-hydroxylase and deficiency of 5-alpha-reductase. Just concentrate over here. 17-beta-hydroxylase is required for the conversion of dehydroepiandrosterone to testosterone, and then dihydrotestosterone, that is the active form of testosterone, this conversion takes place by 5-alpha-reductase hormone. So if these two hormones are absent, there would be only DHEA, which would get aromatized to estradiol. So there would be estrogen formation, but there would not be testosterone and then dehydrotestosterone formation. And then what will happen? This is called as androgen insensitivity syndrome or testicular feminizing syndrome. So imagine now, the person has genotype as XY. Once there is Y, there is selection of gonad, SRY, testes are formed. Testes, they give rise to anti-Müllerian substance. Anti-Müllerian substance will hamper the Müllerian growth, so there will not be any Müllerian growth present like uterus and fallopian tubes. They will not be there. Now these testes, they are secreting and trying to form testosterone, but this conversion is avoided. There is no testosterone, there is no dehydrotestosterone. So because of this, or maybe because the peripheral receptors are not receptive, there would be no action of these hormones on the peripheral cells. So that will lead to either the external genitalia will be hypoplastic, Again, growth of pubic hair and axillary hair would not be satisfied. And because the whole of the dehydroepiandrosterone is getting converted into estrogen, estrogen is in enough amount because of aromatization. And this estrogen acts, there would be good breast development, there would be female-like fat deposition. So even though this person is a man, he will look like a female. So phenotype would be female. Genotype is 46XY. Gonads present at testes. They are usually intra-abdominal or in the inguinal canal, and we have to remove them. Uterus is absent because of presence of Müllerian inhibiting factor. Vagina is present because of estrogen and because of hypoplastic action, because there is no testosterone. That is why the external genitalia are not formed as male. There is just a blind pouch. Breast development, very good, like Tanner's, maybe stage 4. Scanty pubic hair and axillary hair. And if you do investigation, testosterone can be low, normal or high. But there are no receptors and the active form is absent. So depending on which hormone is deficient, the levels of the testosterone will change. And as this is not having negative feedback on the pituitary hormones, LH level will be very high, because body perceives that there is no testosterone. So LH is continuously secreted from the pituitary to make the testosterone secretion. So LH level would be high. Karyotyping will make it clear. Management is remove the testes, because again there is risk of seminoma formation. Estrogen supplement and vaginoplasty. Because this is phenotypic female, so at least we can help her to have sexual activity and to maintain her feminine look, we should give her exogenous estrogen. So this makes us to understand what is androgen insensitivity or testicular feminizing syndrome. Now coming to the another syndrome, that is Klinefelter's. In Klinefelter's, the problem is there is one extra X. The genotype is XXY. So because of this extra X, there is a problem. Y is present, that leads to formation of testes. Testes causes anti-Müllerian secretion. That is why Müllerian system is not formed. But now these testes, they are not very responsive. So there is no testosterone formation. Testicular failure kind of picture is there. Because of which, even though the genotype is XXY, the man looks like a male, but not like a complete male. The gonads will be testes. Uterus is absent. External genitalia hypoplastic. Secondary sexual characteristics, there would be formation of gynecomastia, because estrogen, the breasts are very well developed. Other features, long arms and legs. Because of the presence of extra X, the patient would be chromatin positive. Only females are chromatin positive. The bar body is present only in females. So, but because there are, even though in presence of Y, this will show chromatin positive because of presence of 2X. And management is, as from childhood, this person is being brought up as a male, we should continue that and give testosterone because that is lacking. So we can give testosterone doses to this person. Many of the eunuchs would be seen like Klinefelter's, where there would be scanty hair growth and gynecomastia would be seen. Testosterone will help them. They usually have some psychotic elements or psychosocial problems. Now coming to another condition, this is congenital adrenal hyperplasia, autosomal recessive disorder. This is it's actually a female hermaphrodite, now we are going to call. So what is the problem? There is deficiency of 21 beta hydroxylase, and because of this, there would be low cortisol level, a steroid which is mandatory for our survival, that is not getting formed. Hence, the response, negative feedback is absent. So there is more and more secretion of adrenocorticotropic hormone that would lead to adrenal hyperplasia. There is secretion of excessive gonads, excessive androgens, and these androgens will go and act on the developing fetus, and the genitalia, instead of converting into female, they are forming like male. So the genitalia will be ambiguous. Again, I'm going to the slide of the steroid hormone production and trying to show you where is the problem. the problem is at this level. There is either deficiency of this 21 beta hydroxylase, which is forming aldosterone, and the same hormone is required to form the cortisol. So the hormone deficiency will not allow formation of these two life-saving hormones or these two elements, and because of which there would be problem. This will also lead to sodium losing, that means wasting kind of thing, where there is hyponatremia and there would be hyperkalemia. So that will present as a crisis at the time of birth. There would be formation of other elements like DHEA will form and estradiol will be formed. Even there would be conversion to testosterone, and that will have androgenic action on the genitalia. Phenotype is male. That means even though the baby is having XX, looks like a male because of excessive androgen production. The gonads are ovaries, which are functionless. Because of XX, absent Y, immediately the gonads are formed into ovaries, but ovaries are not functioning properly. Internal genitalia would be uterus, fallopian tubes and ovaries, because anti-Müllerian substance is not released as the gonads are ovary, so they are forming there. External genitalia will be ambiguous. There is formation of small vagina, fused labia and clitoromegaly will be there. Secondary sexual characteristic will be present, and it may lead to precocious puberty, but heterosexual type, that because of excessive androgen, heterosexual type of picture would be there and precocious puberty may be there. Investigations in the form of ultrasound, sex chromatin study, it will be positive. Electrolytes will tell us the differentiating point, and 17-hydroxyprogesterone would be more than 8 mg per ml. Treatment, life-saving treatment is high doses of cortisone are mandatory. This patient should keep on receiving cortisone to survive. And to have sexual life, we can give or we can do vaginoplasty, that is McIndoe surgery, and they can be sexually active. Now let's see the next syndrome, which is quite commonly seen and called as Mayer-Rokitansky-Kuster-Hauser syndrome. This is purely Müllerian agenesis or Müllerian abnormality. We know that once there is presence of 2X, the gonad forms into ovaries. Ovaries immediately, there is no, because of absence of Müllerian inhibiting factors, there is formation of Müllerian system from which fallopian tubes, uterus and upper portion of vagina forms. So in this, if there is a problem, what will happen? Because of presence of ovaries, there would be no formation of testosterone. Estrogen would be there because of secretion from a changing or formation of the steroid hormones. Thus, that will make her look like female phenotypically. So, it's not a type of hermaphrodite. Only the presentation can be primary amenorrhea because of these Müllerian changes or Müllerian abnormalities. So, phenotypically very much female. Genotype is also 45XX. The ovaries are normal. What is the problem? Fallopian tubes, uterus can be absent or hypoplastic. External genitalia, that is vagina, can be absent or hypoplastic. Again, Müllerian abnormality, or usually there is just a blind pouch is seen. Secondary sexual characteristics, breast will be well formed. Even axillary and pubic hair would be normal in growth because of estrogenic effect. Investigation, usual presentation, I said that primary amenorrhea, because there is no Greek analyzation. If the uterus is functional, then there may be cryptomenorrhea, that is collection. But most of the times the uterus is hypoplastic, non-functioning. So there is complete amenorrhea. There is no formation of any fluid, no collection. And a small blind pouch is seen. Karyotype would be normal. And management in this, we cannot give her any fertility. But we can have vaginoplasty, McIndoe surgery, in which she can be sexually active. So this is what is called as Mayer-Rokitansky-Kuster-Hauser syndrome. Now that finishes the topic. Let's revise it. For your MCQ point of view, there is poor secondary sexual characteristics. Person is short stature. The moment short stature, Turner should come to our mind. Webbing of neck confirms. Tubitus valgus adds to it. Congenital muscular malformation of the cardiac, renal and great vessels. These are all additional points. External genitalia underdeveloped, gonads streak, the diagnosis is nothing but Turner's. Normal breast development, scanty pubic and axillary hair. This is the different point. Breasts are well developed, but pubic hair scanty. Immediately think of androgen insensitivity because estrogen component reactive, testosterone component missing, pubic hair and axillary hair less. Average stature, external genitalia, labial or inguinal gonads, means they may be in the abdominal cavity or maybe in the inguinal cavity. There is short blind vagina and absence of uterus. So this confirms the diagnosis that the vagina is a blind pouch and uterus is totally absent. Again, very clear cut, it is androgen insensitivity syndrome. Next, normal phenotype, female, average stature, external genitalia showing labial fusion and enlargement of clitoris. Internal genitalia, they are normal. So that means she is kind of a female where internal organs are well developed. External appearing like male. So virilizing, causes of virilizing, adrenogenital syndrome. Over here, it is not mentioned that there is crisis. Sodium and that retention is not there. Hyperkalemia is not mentioned. So because of that, it may be late onset type of disease. But it is adrenogenital syndrome. Feature of hypogonadism, that means short stature, there is mental retardation and obesity, external genitalia underdeveloped, internal underdeveloped. What would be the causes? Hypogonadism. So the cause may be related with pituitary or hypothalamus. Hypogonadism. Short stature, height is not, hypothalamus, mental retardation, obesity. So the causes all related there. So either think of hypothalamo-pituitary dysfunction. The causes are Kallmann syndrome, Prader-Willi syndrome or Lawrence-Mohn-Biddle syndrome, or it is just plain hypothyroidism leading to cretinism.